My hallelujah of holy responsibility. Truly, Lord, our hallelujahs belong to you. The highest praise, Lord. Because you have been good in spite of our situation. So we thank you this morning, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for life, health, and strength. We thank you, Lord, that we're able to come before your presence with thanksgiving because we truly believe that this is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. We will not let circumstances hinder us. We will not let what we see bother us, but we will remember what you said. I'm with you always, even until the ends of the earth. And we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for this company of friends who are here today. We pray, Lord, that what is done and said will be done to your glory, will be done to your honor and to your praise. Because you and you alone are worthy of all praise. So we thank you now. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you, Lord. Because that is not
I'm
Second Kings, the sixth chapter, verses 8-17. Following that, the selection that praise be, and then the word of God.
Verses 8-17, I'll be reading from the King James Version. Then the king of Syria warred against Israel and took counsel with his servants, saying, "In such and such a place shall be my camp." And the man of God sent unto the king of Israel, saying, "Beware that thou pass not such a place, for thither the Syrians are come down." And the king of Israel sent to the place which the man of God told him and warned him of, and saved himself there, not once nor twice. Therefore the heart of the king of Syria was sore troubled for this thing. And he called his servants and said unto them, "Will ye not show me which of us is for the king of Israel?" And one of his servants said, "None, my lord, O king, but Elisha the prophet that is in Israel. Tell the king of Israel the words that thou speakest in thy bedchamber." And he said, "Go and spy where he is, that I may send and fetch him." And it was told him, saying, "Behold, he is in Dothan. Therefore send ye thither horses and chariots and a great host." And they came by night and compassed the city about. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early and gone forth, behold, an host compassed the city, both with horses and chariots. And his servant said unto him, "Alas, my master, how shall we do?" And he answered, "Fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them." And Elisha prayed and said, "Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes, that he may see." And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw. And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha. The word of God for the people.
We just want to praise you forever. Come on, put your hands together.
Oh!
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Listen to me.
title caught my attention a few days ago. It was called Overcoming Life's Challenges. It was written by Bill Crowder. He's a staff writer for our Daily Bread Ministries. And at a second glance, I thought to myself, that book already exists. It's called the Bible. Yes. The Bible is the Word of God. Mm-hmm. It is God's book written to humankind. The Bible is God's guidebook for how to live our lives. Yes. Sometimes referred to as basic instructions before leaving earth. In Paul's second letter to Timothy, we find these words in the third chapter, verses 14 through 17. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast been known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation, through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is given by inspiration. It's God-breathed. God breathed into those men as they were writing the words that he was giving them to say. Mm-hmm. For it's profitable for doctrine. Mm-hmm. It's good for instruction and teaching, for reproof. It convicts us of our sins, for correction of errors and discipline and obedience, for instruction in righteousness, holy living, conforming to God's will, that the man of God may be perfect. Thoroughly furnished, that is to be completely decked out, or to be fully supplied, or completely equipped unto all good works. Psalms 119 is perhaps the best known for being the longest chapter in the Bible. But what people don't know is that this psalm is an extremely structured poem praising the Word of God. One of the most famous verses of this psalm is verse 105. The psalmist declares, thy word is a lamp unto thy feet and a light unto thy path. Amen. In this verse, the writer proclaims the importance of God's word. God's word is a light and lamp to all who hear and read. The word of God is an inextinguishable lamp. It never goes out to guide us along the right path, and it is a radiant light that banishes the shades of uncertainty by illuminating the next step in this sin-soaked world. God's word is a light of truth that is written for our learning to lead us away from every shadowy danger that crosses our path, and to strengthen our faith in our Savior as he gently leads us. It lifts the darkness before us and straightens every crooked path. His word not only brightens our pathway, guards us on our journey through life, and warns us of each waiting danger, but it is a treasure trove of precious gemstones to be hidden deep in our heart. For it contains words of wisdom to guide us in our thinking, precious promises to encourage our hearts, godly instruction on how to live as the Lord desires us to live. And it is the perfect pattern for Christian living, as well as the qualified adjudicator of our daily conduct. We do well to read, to mark, to learn, and to inwardly digest the Word of God, and to guard it within our hearts. For it is a lamp to our feet, a light to our path, and it brightens up every corner of our lives. For it is God's instruction, it's God's instrument to lead us into holiness and to guide our feet into his way of truth. The Bible's purpose is twofold. The first is to show us that all have broken God's law. James 2:10 declares, for whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point is guilty of all. God's law reveals how all people have sinned against God and are deserving of his full judgment. This ultimately shows our need for sin. At the same time, the sinner and the whole point of the Bible is Jesus. Jesus is the Savior, but he wants to be our Savior. John the Baptist called him the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. The gospel proclaims the good news that through the death of Jesus on the cross, sin's debt has been paid and God's wrath has been satisfied. And by the resurrection from the dead, all who believe shall receive eternal life. Thus the word of God is a light and a lamp, because it shows how all have fallen short of God's law and how God lovingly came to save sinners by dying in our place. This twofold message of law and gospel shows us the unconceivableness, the unconceivable mercy and grace of Jesus Christ towards us. From our previously read scripture this morning, from verse 17, and Elijah prayed, "Open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see." Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked and saw the hills were full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elijah. From our subject, from this scripture, our subject for the morning: seeing the unseen.
All right.
Seeing the unseen. On this post-resurrection Sunday, we begin our summary with verse 8. Now the king of Syria was at war with Israel. Mm-hmm. And after conferring with his officers, he said, "I will set up my camp at such and such a place." Now it seems the king of Syria wants to capture the king of Israel. Now with an all-out war, not with an all-out war, bringing his entire army, but taking a small camp with him to try and ambush the king. Elijah, the prophet of God, was not going to let this happen. He sent word to the king of Israel in verse 9, "Beware of passing that place, because the Syrians are going to be down there." So the king of Israel checked on the place indicated by the man of God. Time and time again, Elijah warned the king so that he was on guard in such places, whether he had guards with him or whether he did not. Now the king of Israel does not know what's going on. And he asked the question, who is conspiring with the enemy? But one of his officers replied in verse 12, "None of us are on the side of the king of Israel, my lord the king, but Elijah, the prophet, who is in Israel, tells the king of Israel the very words you speak in your bedroom." And some of us are worried about Alexa. Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, then ordered his men to find out where Elijah was, so that he could send men and capture him. Now it's funny that the king of Israel wanted to send men to capture Elijah. Had he forgotten that Elijah was the one who was giving out the secret locations, right, and telling the king of Israel the very words he spoke in his bedroom? Uh-huh. You would think that he should know that the God we serve was also going to protect Elijah and prevent him from being captured. Right. So the report came back in verse 13, "He is in Dothan." Mm-hmm. 14, "Then the king of Syria sent horses and chariots and a strong force there." And the scripture says they went by night and surrounded the city. Mm-hmm. Verse 15 says, early the next morning, the servant of the man of God went out and saw an army of horses and chariots surrounding the city. Uh-huh. Imagine if you were waking up one morning and then going outside for a stretch or to jog or to get some breakfast, and you see a host of police cars surrounding your house. Uh-huh. The servant was terrified. Yes. And he cried out to Elijah, "Oh no, my Lord, what shall we do?"
Yeah.
What shall we do? Over the last few months, how many of us, including the children of God, have asked that question? What shall we do? COVID-19. What are we going to do? When will it end, and how soon can we return to what we call the way we were? Elisha had his problem with Syria, and we had our problems with coronavirus disease. But God, is still the same God. And he's still sending invisible areas, invisible help in our time of need. Look at Elijah's response in verse 16. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. The prophet answered, those that are with us are more than those who are with them. Elijah gave a calm and confident response. This was such a strange answer, but we see what Elijah was talking about in verse 17. So my response to you, the children of God, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Then in verse 17, and Elijah prayed, open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see. Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked and saw, and the hills were full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elijah. When we pray, something happens. When we pray, something happens. And when we call on the name of the Lord, even the devil has to flee. In a materialistic world like ours, we are tempted to conclude that the only real things are those we experience with our five senses. Yet there are things we cannot see. Things behind our back, or far away, are all things that are in the dark. So says C.S. Lewis. There is another realm of reality, just as actual, just as factual, just as sustainable as anything we see, hear, touch, taste, or smell in this world. It exists all around us. Not out there, somewhere, but here. There are legions of angels helping us, for which the world has no countermeasures. Hebrews 1:14. The psalmist David referred to them as a force of 20,000, even thousands of angels. We cannot see them, nor can we see God with our natural eyes, but they are there, whether we see them or not. Whether we believe it or not, they are filled in the world. And I have had a personal experience with them myself, so I know that angels exist. What about you? Faith is the means by which we are able to see the invisible world. That is what belief's true function is all about. Faith is in the spiritual realm, is what the five senses are in the natural realm. By faith, we recognize the existence of the spiritual world, and we learn to depend on God for his help in our daily life. Our goal then, as George MacDonald once said, is to grow eyes to see the unseen. Gehazi was the name of Elijah's servant, who arrived early to discover the waiting army. The city is surrounded, and to the natural eye, there is no hope of deliverance. He could only ask his master, rather, Elijah, what shall we do? Elijah's answer is one repeated throughout the scriptures on numerous occasions. When faced with overwhelming odds, when the natural eye is looked on and there seems to be no hope and all is lost, God's word commands us boldly by saying, fear not, fear not, fear not. Fear not. Yes. Affirmation is given in 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us the spirit of fear. but a power of love and a sound mind. Elijah was not bold to declare fear or not, but is calm in his answer to his servant. He said, fear. Fear is false evidence, appearing real, is a spiritual force that can only work against the plan of God. It is important that Jehovah not fear. It is important that we not fear. For fear could hamper and limit the ministry of the angels. Elijah has no reason to fear. His faith rested in spiritual reality. Gehazi, however, was limited by natural perception. The thing that he saw with his physical eye dominated his thinking and placed him in a realm of fear. Is that what we're doing? Do we allow what we see to determine what it is? Or do we realize that we walk by faith and not by sight? Once the man of God prayed, Lord, open his eyes, Gehazi was able to see into the realm of the spirit. What was present all the time was now made visible to Elijah's servant. Elijah was bold to declare, there are more that be with us than they that be with them. It's the same today, church, people of God. There are more that be with us than they that be with them. Don't look at your circumstances. Look to Jesus, the author and finisher of every perfect work. Remember that we walk by faith, not by sight, and God is not limited. God is not limited by the circumstances or the issues that hinder us. He's moved by our confession of faith and our willingness to stand in the midst of our trials. Stand tall and see the salvation of the Lord. Sometimes we miss the truth by its simplicity. Notice what Elijah did not say. He did not say, there are more that be with us than them. He was not comparing the host of angels and chariots of fire with the enemies encircling the city. He said, there are more that be with us than they that be with them. Yes. Elijah was comparing the host of angelic forces who had come to his aid with the demonic forces that were driving the king of Syria and his army. Yes. Paul taught us that we do not war against the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Our battle is not with men. The real battle lies on the spiritual side, and the real war is waged in the unseen places. There are spiritual conflicts that take place between the host of heaven and the kingdom of God. Ephesians 6:13 says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. There is a reciprocal law in the natural and in the spiritual. There is what we call a cause and effect that operates. Things that are bound on earth are bound in heaven, and things that are loosed on earth are loosed in heaven. Yes. It takes a spiritual eye to discern that spiritual event that affects the natural. We also must learn that natural events affect the spiritual world. Yes. Elijah knew this, and he knew how to operate in the spiritual world. We realize that fear paralyzes angelic ministry. He understood that his battle was not with men who had come to deliver him to their king. He saw that Satan and demonic powers were at work in the realm of the spirit. But he knew angelic ministry was sufficient to give him the victory. Let us open our spiritual eyes and realize that God has not forsaken us in our present pandemic state. Our counsel is still the Holy Spirit. And we must remember we have a charged to keep.
Yes.
And a God to glorify.
Amen.
What an amazing sight. While he saw the Syrian army out in the distance, closer to them, he saw God's army, an army of angels surrounding Elijah and his servant. This reminds me of a song that some of us may have learned as children. All day, all night, angels watching over me, my Lord. All night, all day, angels watching over me. Now I lay me down to sleep, angels watching over me. My Lord, pray my Lord, my soul to keep. Angels watching over me. What a comfort. What a security. What a protection God provides. There were horses of chariots of fire that the Assyrian army could not see. It was an army that had a heavenly radiance. These were like the horsemen and chariots of fire that Elijah had seen before when Elijah was taken up into heaven. The same army that delivered Elijah from death would now deliver Elisha from the king of Syria. These horsemen and chariots of fire were not merely images, but they were real spiritual beings that exist that we cannot see because God has hidden the spiritual world from our sight. Psalm 34:7 says, the angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them. This sounds like a lot, like the angels are doing for Elijah and his servant. The angel of the Lord encamped around those who fear God and delivers them. Are you one of those? If you allow yourself to be encamped, if you come to Jesus and allow him to have lordship over your life, you too can be saved.
Yes.
Psalms 91. 9-11 says, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague, any COVID-19, any coronavirus disease, any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angel charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways.
Yes.
Now let me just pause for a minute and tell you that this scripture comes with a warning label.
Yes.
I said this scripture, Psalm 91, comes with a warning label. That is, no blessing can come to you unless you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ.
Yes.
No blessing comes to you unless you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
God sends his angels to guard us in our way, but only those who trust in him. Hebrews 1:14 says, are not all angels ministering spirits sent to serve those who will inhabit salvation? Angels are sent to help us and to guard us, but remember, it is not the angels that we must put our trust in. Our trust ultimately, it's not in angels. Our trust is in the Lord.
Yes.
It's in Jesus Christ, who is the commander and chief of all the armies of angels.
Yes.
2 Corinthians 4:18 says, so we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on which is unseen.
Yes.
Since what is seen is temporary, and that which is unseen is eternal. Temporary versus eternal have vast different meanings. The way we process, the way we handle, the way we manage the differences can determine the level of peace and contentment we experience in our Christian life.
Mm-hmm.
If we apply most of our focus on the temporary, we will struggle to find peace. But if we focus on the eternal, we will feel a great burden lifted from our shoulders.
Amen.
Matthew 11:28-30 says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. To allow the eternal to give you peace requires a measure of faith. Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for,
yes. The
evidence of things not seen. Faith is the basic ingredients needed to begin your relationship with Jesus Christ. Faith means believing that God, who loves you and knows all things, has placed you in this world at this time. I said, has placed you in this world at this time and in these circumstances for a reason.
Yes.
Everything that happens to you happens for a reason. Yes. Nothing just happens.
Right.
Everything you witness happens for a reason. Every pain in your body, every sacrifice you make, every tear that you shed, every loss of a loved one,
yes. Your
state of joblessness, a broken relationship, heartache and headache, even a stab in the back by a trusted friend can help build Christian character and integrity in you. We are being educated and tested as individuals every day in every way.
Yes.
It is easy to allow the temporary, the day in and day out, to consume all of our energies and efforts. Our job, the temporary, requires much attention. Our physical bodies, temporary, needs constant maintenance. The state of our finances, temporary, causes our emotions to fluctuate mercilessly at times. Plenty of money, we're good. Not enough money, we're not good. Keeping up with our material stuff requires much attention. The temporary, physical aspect of life can be hard. Now we have to add COVID-19. Might I also add temporary.
Right.
Fortunately, we can choose to find peace and happiness by turning our thoughts to the eternal.
Yes.
The eternal heaven, everlasting life, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance, and even the angels.
Mm-hmm.
Is promised to the faithful followers. There will come a day when we will realize that the stress and the worration and all the hours that we spent on the temporary, we will soon realize that it was a waste of time. Philippians 4:8-9 says, finally, brother, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Those things which ye have both learned and received, and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. Do you really believe that we can turn our focus away from our work and our home and stuff with all the disturbing news we hear and read on a daily basis? For some, maybe not. But we can learn balance.
Yeah.
And we can learn to replace the stressful, worrying, distracting thoughts concerning the temporary with peaceful, contented, joyous thoughts about the eternal. 2 Corinthians 10:5 says, we demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, that we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. Not easy, I agree, but possible.
Yes.
If the Lord told us to do it, it can and should be done.
Right.
When the load gets too heavy to worry about the physical plane, that's the scene, we can light the load by dwelling on the spiritual plane. That's the unseen.
Mm-hmm.
We must allow the Holy Spirit to empower us to see through the eyes of faith.
Yes.
Always remember, faith is the confidence that what we hope for will actually happen.
Mm-hmm.
It gives us assurance about things we cannot see.
Mm-hmm.
There is so much going on around us that most of us never see with our spiritual eyes.
Mm-hmm.
But through faith, we can believe that they're all real, and everything we see is not to be perceived with our physical eye.
Mm-hmm.
And those things we cannot see are not hindered in any way by time and space. It is those things, those eternal, supernatural things that will carry us through eternity. We must walk through this temporary life with some measure of attention to physical details, but we must never, I repeat, we must never allow them to overshadow the beautiful, magnificent, glorious, eternal, unseen blessings from our God Almighty. And maybe, just maybe, every now and then the Lord will open our eyes to give us a glimpse of the eternal glory that surrounds us all. Even if he doesn't, looking for it is a good spiritual exercise. Finally, may God open our eyes to see that he is a loving and merciful and glorious Father. Romans 5:8 says, but God commanded his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God knows our thoughts, he knows our sinful heart, but he has not removed his love from us. God loves you and he loves me. And he has loved us from the beginning. And he has proven that through his son, Jesus Christ. The punishment for our sins was death. But God sent his son to die for us. To take our punishment away. Therefore, in Christ, we may receive forgiveness for all our sins. In Christ, peace has been made between us and God. Christ has made us right with God. In Christ, we need not fear. Romans 8:31-32 says, what shall we say then to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us, how shall we not with him also freely give us all things? A cure for COVID-19, healing in your body, improved family relationships, increase in your finances, but most of all, of all the things that he freely gives to us, is salvation and a home in glory forever and ever and ever and ever and forevermore. I'd like to end with a verse from Ephesians 1:18. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you. The riches of your glorious inheritance is his holy people. May the eyes of your heart be enlightened so that you may know the hope that God has called you to. The riches of his glorious inheritance. An inheritance for all who believe and trust in Jesus Christ to save them. An inheritance that will never, somebody say never, that will never perish, never spoil, never fade. Eternal life, eternal peace, eternal joy in heaven above with Christ Jesus our Lord. See the unseen. Seeing the unseen. Seeing the unseen. I don't know about you, but in these times, I'm going to trust in the Lord. The songwriter said, I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord till I die. I will trust in the Lord. I question that your head is asking. What are we going to do? We're going to wait on the Lord.
Yes.
We're going to depend on Him to do what only He can do, no matter what happens. We're going to be like those three Hebrew boys that were put into the fire. They were in a win-win situation. They said, even if He doesn't spare us, we know that He can.
Yes.
So as a result of that, they went in. And we have to be that way. We have to say, no matter what happens, went in away.
Yeah.
And as you know the story, they went in and the king said, I put in three.
Yes.
But it looks like a fourth man walking in the fire.
Yeah.
And that fourth person is the same person who can walk with you as you walk through your daily life.
Yeah.
They said it looks like the Son of God.
Yeah.
We're happy to know that God is still on the throne.
Yeah.
And that His Son Jesus is alive and well, interceding for us. He understands what we are going through, and He's able to carry us and deliver us from what it is that we're dealing with. So we say, keep the faith. Keep your eyes on the Lord, and you shall come through victorious. Now unto Him that is able to keep you from falling, and to present you faultless before the presence of His glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, now and forevermore. And the church said,
let the church say amen. Let the church say amen.